Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for joining. I'm actually pretty impressed that for the last sessions of the last day, there's so many people, so thank you very much for joining. My name is Julien, and I will be talking about multi-data center setup with Cassandra and operation pain points. So we'll start going through some kind of refresher. So since this is a beginner talk, I will go through core notions of Cassandra that are more related to multi-data center and corresponding configuration that you will find in the Cassandra YAML file. So we'll go through that. There's some amount of notions to go through. I initially planned to actually have something more hands-on to show you how to bootstrap nodes, et cetera, but since the sessions are shorter this year, I actually have to remove something from that that session. So I choose to keep the operation pain points, which is more based on experience and the things that you might have to expect when you are bootstrapping and maintaining a Cassandra cluster on a multi-data center scheme. And then we'll do Q&A. So if any of you have questions, unless it gets out of control, let's maybe, you know, like just raise your hands and do it interactively. I don't mind it unless we have, you know, 10 people all the time, but feel free, we can try to answer the questions as they come. So why am I talking about multi-data centers? It's because I'm working for a cloud provider, and as the accent indicates, from Texas in Houston, right? Texas accent, huh? I'm sure you guessed that. So we are very little, like a small cloud provider, and we're specialized in, you know, disaster recovery and stuff like that. We've been like a big Apache Cassandra user since version 1.2. And if you want to see what we do as a use case as a company, you can check the talk I gave last year at the summit. It will describe what we do with Cassandra for public cloud analytics and a certain amount of things. And you can, I'm not going to talk about the company some more. We don't really have the time. All right, so let's go through key notions and configuration. So what is Apache Cassandra? So at its core, it's a distributed partition rule store, and it basically has a physical multi-data center native support. So why I'm basically like putting that here is because this is mainly the reason why we actually went with Cassandra ourselves, because we had the native multi-data center support. In opposition to other databases, usually it's often an afterthought to add that that layer. But in Cassandra, it's definitely at its core and from the beginning. So it means that lots of the features of Cassandra are actually tailored or optimized, designed for multi-data centers. So I know that like not everybody is doing multi-data center like deployment, so but there are multiple reasons why you might want to actually do it. So the first reason, and this is our case at iLand, is that we have a distributed application. So we have 6 data centers. Every data center basically provides cloud platforms for our customers, and we basically have like all this infrastructure, so the compute, the storage, the network, the orchestration engine, et cetera, running at one place. So we basically choose to have an application for our platform running right next to this infrastructure, gathering analytics and a certain amount of information around it. So basically distributed application geographically. Another thing is if you want to do isolation, if you have applications that are like very heavy on writes or very heavy on reads, you might want to actually split that and basically dedicate a data center, and we will see what a data center means in Cassandra, to actually optimize your performances and your application or applications if you have like multiple leveraging those. Another like fairly hot, I would say, use case these days is the disaster recovery case, where basically you would be having one multiple data centers and basically dedicate some data centers in case of a major outage or disaster, so that your application can actually switch to the other one in a fairly easy way. And Cassandra actually is a pretty good database. If all your data are in there, you have the replication in place, it's actually a pretty good choice to do so. And another one, which is like very hot as well, is the analytics. So Spark is pretty hot at the moment. People use it for good reasons with Cassandra because the both of them are actually working really great together. But when you start using Spark, you will basically put some pressure on your network that can actually disrupt your application running like depending on Cassandra. That would be true if you use something something like Elasandra. We had a great presentation earlier today where they were explaining very clearly that the load on the nodes after adding that were increasing, which totally makes sense. So you could basically dedicate as well data center for that reason. So let's see what Cassandra does really at a higher level. And the red line is basically the part that concerns the multi-data center scheme. So when you write in Cassandra, you basically write in a commit in a commit log. So it's basically a flat fly on the system. Then that file gets synced up and sent to memory in something we call memtable. So you can read about that. Of course, I'm not going to go in details right now about it. But it's important to understand. So goes to memory. And then at some point, something happens when the memory, the memtable is full or whatever, like other reason. It gets serialized on disk in what we call the SS table, sorted string tables. When it's there, what's happening is that this is where the magic's happening. You don't have to shard your to take care of sharding your data at the application level. Cassandra is gonna basically write, partition, and replicate your data according to your current configuration automatically and all for you. And this is that what we're gonna see in a couple of minutes. So that's where the magic's happening. This is where it's really powerful and perfect for multi-data center settings. So after when it's done, we have like something that you've been hearing all week for sure. So the compaction are happening on those SS tables. One of the reasons is to clean tombstones. And then you have these other things that everybody's talking about is the repairs. And the repairs is basically to ensure consistency. So that's a pretty big beast for a multi-data center setup, and we'll see that in the operation pain points later. So let's see the Cassandra hierarchy of elements. So we have basically a cluster, right? A cluster has data centers. Data centers, they have what Cassandra call racks. Racks has servers, and at the bottom of it, the most abstracted layer is the vNodes. So let's dig into those. So the Cassandra cluster is basically sum total of all the servers that you have in your database throughout all data centers, okay? It's basically spanning physical location, and what's really important to understand here is that you don't have cross-cluster replication. The replication is basically happening at the key space level, at the data center level, and this is what we're gonna see after. So cluster, it's everything that you have in your cluster across all data centers, and there's no cross-cluster replication possible. So you define your cluster and you define your replication strategy at that point. Cassandra YAML, typically this is the first thing you will change when you bootstrap your cluster, is the name of the cluster, and the only reason for that is that it avoids having like people bootstrapping nodes on the same network and basically one node joining by mistake your cluster. So what's the data center? So a data center, and we can understand it like fairly easily these days with cloud deployment. Ultimately, what it is right now, if you use like cloud deployment, is basically just a grouping of nodes that you configure together for replication purpose. So, of course, like it will correspond mostly to a location or a zone in AWS or something like that. But ultimately, this is what it is: just a group of nodes that you configure together for replication purpose. What you have to understand as well is that the data center, one data center, has a complete, what we call token ring. Basically, full data set will be in every single data center. So then you have the data center has a collection of racks. So what's the racks? So it's just a collection of servers. The most common use case that you'll see is people using one rack per data center. And if you do like cloud deployment, you really don't have to worry about it because your cloud provider, hopefully, is actually taking care of like resiliency and putting VMs at the right place. But if you do physical hardware, definitely this is where it's here. It's gonna allow you to specify physically where those physical machines are and basically tell Cassandra, okay, this is two different zones, and Cassandra will basically do its best to place the replicas in an optimum manner so that if one rack is actually going offline, you'll be in less trouble than if you have in that case. So then you have the Cassandra server. So the Cassandra server is basically the software. It's what you would download, put somewhere, and just start. Okay? It's called as well a node. You'll see it named the node as well. And this is when it gets like a little bit tricky, is that it basically contains what's called virtual nodes. So virtual nodes is something that got introduced in 1.2, and it was really fantastic because before that, you actually had to basically assign tokens to every of your nodes and basically compute like ranges, etc. It was pretty complicated for newcomers to actually start. So that's what it's basically trying to do. And the advantage as well is that you don't have to rebalance your cluster. Everything is done for you automatically. And you basically ensure that you have a balanced cluster, and you don't have to do any kind of like manual operations to keep it this way. By default, you have 256 tokens. Again, Cassandra YAML, this is where you will find it. And there's a lot of talk around it, so I'm not gonna like go too deep on it, but if you're basically like newcomers, or if you're bootstrapping a new cluster, you don't know what capacity you need, you don't know what kind of application is gonna run on it, don't ask yourself any question, just go for it. After that, there are possibilities where you might want to actually have less tokens, or if you know exactly the amount of data and the capacity that you need for a cluster, it might be more interesting to go manual and assign tokens and do it the old way, meaning that it's been introduced, but the old way of assigning token and computing ranges automatically, it exists as well. So just know that it's possible. If you know the data, if you know how much capacity you need, you will be able to do it manually. So like that. So we have the partition after that, which is basically the individual unit of data. And each copy of the partition is called a replica. So the vnodes, the thing to remember is that each vnode has one token. The token basically, each vnode basically assigns, sorry. You have basically the hashing, which is handled by the partitioner. So the partitioner is basically a function that is going to take a partition key, transform it, and associate it to partition key. So that partition key, basically, when the hash is happening, since we know the ranges for all the actual nodes, and we'll see that an example after that, we can actually know from the hash on which node it's supposed to be stored. The partitioner, this is what's available. So the first one, the Murmur 3, is basically the default one after 1.2. And you have the byte order partitioner, which is something for compatibility purpose for old cluster. Because the partitioner is hard to migrate, you might need it if you're coming from a very old version. Partitioner, same thing. Again, you most likely don't have like to change that one in most cases. It's here in Cassandra YAML, and this is the default one. So let's take a look at what it means. So this is an extract from the DataStax documentation. So you have that table with name being the partition key, right? When you apply that hash function, so the Murmur 3, you're basically gonna convert the partition key to a hash value. With the vnodes, we basically have each node actually having one range of tokens, right? So we can basically say, okay, node A, the range is from X to Y, the partition key, the hash value after the hash function has been executed is this value, so we know in which node it is. Does that make sense? So to sum up, we have that the cluster notion, which is everything. Then the data center, grouping of nodes for replication purpose. Then we have the racks. If you're running like off the cloud, don't really worry about it. One rack, most common setup. Otherwise, this is something that you will want to dig into it if you're using physical hardware. The servers is basically, or the node, is basically the Cassandra software. And the vnode is the data abstraction that makes it easy for you to actually get your data replicated and your cluster balance and all your token ranges computed for you. So if we step up a little bit in the abstraction, we don't then have the key space, and this is where it's gonna get interesting. So the key space is basically an namespace container that define how data is replicated on nodes. So let's say, so consider that maybe as a database in SQL world, I don't know. So you would have your key space, it has tables, and this is the key space that is responsible to define how it is replicated. So it means that basically you can have one cluster, multiple key space, but each key space could have a different replication strategy defined. So let's say you have like, a data center in Europe, one in the US, one in Asia. You may want to have the European and US data like synchronized all the time in between each other. But in the same cluster, you may want to have the Asia on themselves. It's usually like very useful for compliance reasons, depending on the kind of data and the industry that you're working with. So the data replication is basically just the process of storing replicas somewhere. The maximum replication factor, so we call that the replication factor. So replication factor, let's say you have in the data center, you have three nodes. The maximum number of your replication maximum is going to be three nodes, obviously. If you have five nodes, that's going to be five nodes. That can never be more than that. What it means is that if you have three nodes and you choose a replication factor of three, all three nodes will have one copy of the data. So the full data set is going to be on every data. If you choose a replication factor of three and you have five nodes, you'll have three nodes maximum having that actual the actual data for one particular replica. And the data replication is basically defined on a per data center basis. As I said earlier, the data center is going to have all the actual data set, no matter what, what we call the docker range. So then you have basically the placement strategy. So what it is that you will define the network topology and basically tell Cassandra how your actual cluster is defined, which data center, what tracks, etc. So that has to be considered depending on basically the failure scenarios that you want to handle. So typically, let me give you an example. So if you have only one node and the node goes down, your application is offline, right? If you have three nodes and you have one node down with a replication factor three and you have all data, then if you're using like some consistency level, like Chrome, we'll see after that what it is, that's gonna be fine. So what's very important to understand is that what we call consistency level is only a notion that is at the client level. So what it means is that you have several ways. So since this is distributed, let's say you're in one data center, right? You got three nodes, you say, okay, let's say I want a consistency level of one. It means that if one node is actually acknowledging the operation, then you're good. If you want the consistency all, this is the strongest type of consistency. It means that every node in the data center, so the three nodes have to actually answer the operation. And what's the most common when you start and in general for most type of data is to use local quorum, which means that a local quorum, if we take an example, let's say you have three nodes, you got a replication factor of three, so one replica on each node, you can actually tolerate one replica being done if you're using the local quorum. If you have five nodes, replication of factor of three, you can tolerate two replica being done, etc. So we have another notion to go through is the snitch. And the snitch is basically about the network topology and is only here to do an effective routing and know where to place the replica. So the snitches, this is the snitches. The one by default, when you take a Cassandra version, is the simple snitch, is for a single DC only. Then you have two that are called the gossiping proper snitch and the property file snitch. You will see that in the configuration file of Cassandra, called Cassandra-DC property and Cassandra topology properties. This is basically the difference. So if you use Cassandra or RackDC properties, you have to put on every node of the cluster the data center identifier as well as the rack identifier on every one of them. So it's one particular file per node. For the topology one, you basically have to have all nodes in that file and that same file, the exact same one, replicated throughout the whole cluster. And there's another one called the rack inferring snitch, and this is my actual favorite because it's basically inferring the data center and the actual rack through the actual IP that you have. So if you actually have like a proper networking done and you're using consistent addressing across your data center, you can basically use this one. So typically, if you have IPs like 1, 2, 3, 4, the data center is going to be 2 and the rack is going to be 3. if you have, and you can then have 1, 2, 3, 4, you're gonna have 4, 5, 6, etc. And they're all gonna be in the same data center in the same rack. And Cassandra does that for you automatically. If you do that, you don't need those configuration files. After, if you use AWS, Google Cloud, or Cloud Stack, you will find dedicated snitch that will make it very easy for you to actually do it. That's how you define the snitch in Cassandra YAML. And the last one is the last notion is a seed node. So the seed node is simply like some node that you elect so that it will be responsible to for the bootstrap process. When you're going to add nodes, this is the node, those new nodes going to contact to actually know about a certain amount of things in your cluster. So by default, you at least need one per data center, but it's a really a good pattern to actually put two in case of one node fail. So it's not going to basically like break your cluster if like you don't have CNOs anymore, but it's going to be really slow because it's going to have to contact and find out by itself a certain amount of information. So the seeds, this is how you define them, seed provider. And as you can see here, I have two data centers. If you remember the rack inferring snitch, you have 239 and 244. One rack, 206 for both of them. And we got two seeds per data center. And the last thing is the gossip. It's basically the process by the peer-to-peer communication protocol. So what we really need to understand here is that all nodes everywhere, they have to be able to chat in between each other. What's happening as well is that each node is persisting the status of the network in system tables in every node. So it's a little bit chatty as well. So do you guys have questions right now? I could take some questions about that before I go to the operation pain points. No, good, all right. Okay, so everything's working quite great. I'm not gonna talk about what's working because a lot is working great. And so let's talk about what's actually pretty complicated. So the process of bootstrapping is very complicated. We're gonna talk about it. The repairs, the hints, tombstones, compaction, indexes, and sig nodes. So let's go through that. So bootstrapping new nodes. So bootstrapping new nodes, if you really have a lot of data, it's really slow, right? So do not expect to just be able to answer like any kind of seasonal traffic or seasonal like peak of resources that you need by just like bootstrapping new nodes. That's not gonna happen. It's gonna be very complicated and you're most likely gonna fail. What you can do then, right? Well, you're gonna have to basically plan your growth and plan your cluster to always have a little bit of resources, like let's say 30%, 40% available for this kind of use case, as well as for operations, like repairs, et cetera, and we're gonna talk about that. But this is pretty important. You will not be able to just like add nodes like that if you have a peak of traffic. Cassandra 2.2, life savior for bootstrapping because it introduced something called a bootstrap resume that was not here before, meaning that if you were bootstrapping, network problems, everything was failing, well, you had to restart from the beginning. So you could have like problems if you have instability or any kind of issue. So 2.2 fixes it, and this is actually pretty great. What you'll see on bootstrapping is that the pressure on the network is pretty high. So what you will need to do is basically play with some properties that are on the streaming. So there's like throttles by default on what kind of traffic will be sent across data center and from one particular node. And usually what we've been doing when bootstrapping new data center is basically increase the throughput from one data center that we would choose to build. So I don't know if I have it. Do I have a laser here? No. So the node to rebuild --DC is when if you have like multiple data centers and you're getting high latency. Let's say you're bootstrapping Singapore, and you will not want to go and get the data from Dallas, for instance. That's a pretty bad idea, high latency. What you would want to do instead is actually choose the closest one. So if you have one in California, maybe, or one in Russia or something. So you would want to basically choose the data center the closest, prepare the data center to and unthrottle or extend a little bit your network, And you have like better chances to be fast at actually bootstrapping your new data center. The other property you will want to play with is the 3-minute socket timeout. If you have like large data, so I think they've been extending that. So that's the latest 3.0, I think. So it's 24 hours now. It used to be like 1 hour, 2 hours. So don't put it like unlimited, because you're going to have like streams that will be just like stuck in there and without errors, and you will not know what happened. But if you have, I don't know, like terabytes of data in one table, for instance, or like large volumes, you might want to play with the timeout, because depending on the network throughput you have, you might need to do it. Okay, so then you got the repairs, and that's like probably, I mean, the biggest pain point, I would say, when you start having high latency and dense data. So repairs, it has to be run, and what's a repair is that you have all these data centers, and every data center is writing data, right? What's happening is that you basically compare the data, so in a data center, like on a quorum, with all the data in the across the cluster, right? So that process is very long, because you have basically to read like all over the place and do comparison. So the bad news is that you actually have to do it before like the GC grace period, which is 10 days by default, and defined on the actual table themselves individually. So what it does is use cluster pressure. So network pressure, IO pressure, you're going to have like some GC fun. So you will basically manage to get a cluster like running, like almost fine, everything's like running okay, and then you start doing a repair and your nodes start crashing, the GC configuration doesn't work anymore, etc. So again, you have to plan for extra cluster capability to run those kind of operations. If you don't, you will have like bad surprises when that's happening. So what can you do about the repair? Well, you have to really think hard about it like from the start. And Alexander from the last speaker had a great talk yesterday. I don't know if any of you actually used it, saw it. But you have to basically have the strategy in place. And you have like several options for that. Either you do custom tuning, you write your own script. That's one thing, right? Or you use DSE and OpenStack that's going to do that for you. Or you use the Spotify Cassandra Reaper. They can actually do that for you. There's a UI on it, and there's two URL, because the first URL from Spotify doesn't support Cassandra, I think, after 2.1. This one is a fork, and actually this guy changed it so that you can use with latest versions. And another thing is that you don't necessarily need to repair everything, right? So nobody's going to tell you that, but actually sometimes if you have a huge table and you know your data and you're not mutating them, just like remove them from the repairs. That will save you some time and some energy. So I have, what, 5 minutes right now? I have 27 minutes. Five? Yes. Okay, so the question was, how do you know when the bootstrap's done, right? So when you run the bootstrap, you will see the node actually in a state called joining. So that will be like, you'll see a G showing up, so you know about that. And what you have to do is use a node tool netstats that's gonna show you like the stream that are happening. Plus, you will need to take the logs and see if any kind of like major errors happen. This is when you know about it. The other question was about the size of the storage. Well, that really depends of your data sets, right? If you bootstrap a new node, a new data center or a new node, you kind of have an idea already of the size of the data, and you basically need to have the same storage as you had on the other nodes, right? Unless you're basically like increasing your number of nodes, and let's say you have 3 nodes, you're getting like really big. You can switch to 5 nodes, keep the same replication factor, and the disk size will be spread across all those 5 nodes. Does it answer your questions?
Yeah, the reason I asked the second part was, you mentioned there was a socket timeout.
Yes.
So
no, not the nodes. It's not all the nodes for 24 hours. It's a streaming operation. The problem is that with the vnodes, you have a lot of streaming that are going to happen, and some of those streaming on large partitions, it's really depending on the partitions.
can actually last for a long time. And that's depending on, again, the size of the data you're streaming, but as well, your network throughput. If you're not able to actually extend it to accommodate the streaming, it can take longer. So it's, I see that they've been putting it to 24 hours, so it's a little bit better than before, because I think it was 1 or 2 hours before, something like that. Yes? Not really. I think like right now you have to use netstat plus telling the logs and to see if you have some stream, if you have some errors, and then node tool will give you the status of the node if whether or not it's bootstrapped.
So you can't say like
100%. No, not really. But you may want to suggest that to the Cassandra developers.
You can get a general idea by looking at the load. Yes.
At the load and at the DD space that's taken, right? If you know like the size of the data set or the chunk of replicas that you will be having on the node, you just take the D size and that will give you an ID, yes. But sometimes if it fails and the data that you can actually like have the wrong ID on a certain percentage, because when you're gonna restart it, you may lose the data after that. If it failed, basically. Yes.
When you are adding a node, you mentioned the C list node, right? Is there any particular order it goes and if the step information for that node is not available, then it goes to the like, sequential or what kind of chooses sequential or something?
When you're bootstrapping it? Well, so either if you don't specify, and this is what I had here, if you don't specify the data center from which, yep, here. If you don't specify the data center from which you want to stream, it will basically try to go like all over the place, and this is like a pretty good, bad idea if you have like, you know, 3, 4, 5 data centers, and some of them have like high latency in between them. So you definitely want to do that, and what's great about it is that you can focus at accommodating the data center from which you're going to stream by increasing the network throttle, and maybe try to, you know, do something so that it's not overloaded to accommodate the extra pressure it's going to get from like streaming somewhere else. One? Okay. All right, 1 minute. Okay. Indexes, pretty hot, all right. No, not indexes. Yeah, that's fine. Let's take some questions maybe, some more.
You have two data centers, and each node has seed node list. So each data center should have the seed list like across the data center nodes, or each data center should have only the local ones.
No. You need to have all of them in all data centers.
Okay.
So it's at least one per data center, and preferably two if that seed node goes down. And when you define your Cassandra YAML configuration, you have to put like all the seeds in every of the actual nodes.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
More questions?
Yes.
If you have say two data centers, and what would be the differences between say you wanted to have one in a disaster recovery type model versus an active model in terms of the client writing or reading quorum or one or that
right
kind of stuff.
So yeah, so one of the possibilities to actually have a active and passive data center, so you basically work always from the same data center. The other one, you put it in the ring, Cassandra does its things, it's basically sitting there doing nothing or maybe do something that's outside the application, so kind of analytics or something. And then at the client level, what you would do is basically say, okay, this is my data center, you will basically monitor for errors. And if you have errors, then you switch your client to use the other data centers, and you can basically do maintenance and get the other one back up, right?
Okay, and then would you be writing quorum or writing one?
Local, well, so if you don't use local quorum, right, and you use like quorum, you're gonna be using like all the two data centers. You don't wanna do that. You would rather like focus on using your data center for what it is, like the main one, and if some errors happening, you use the other one. But then after, what's interesting is that you can, you know, you can basically not let the second one just sit there, but leverage it for, you know, some kind of specific things that you may want to run on your data,
without disrupting the application. It's actually interesting because you can segment and have different services and basically have better performances.
And then if you were active-active, would there be some other considerations for
the latency between the data center? If you put them in the, if you're using AWS or if you're in the same zone, this is fine because you're not going to have latency. If you put one in Europe and one in America, your application is going to run in America and you're using the Europe data center, you're going to increase the latency and that's not good. But again, the data center, just a grouping of nodes for application purpose, right? So you can basically have two defined data center in Cassandra in the same zone in AWS, for instance, and then you're fine, no latency, and you can use both of them at the same time.
One more question? So how does this change if you use advanced replication from DAC5, which is basically the hub and spoke model, right, for replication between two different clusters, essentially?
Two different clusters, active replication, so we're not talking Cassandra here, right?
Cassandra, yeah. But so there's something called advanced replication in DSE5.
DSE?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have no idea.
Okay.
I actually don't know. But yeah, you're right. This is actually one of the features they provide to work around that limitation. And, you know, good for them. I mean, it's a good feature to include in their product, I would say. All right, thank you very much, really. Have a good end of conference. And I'll be around if you have any questions. I'll be happy to answer them.